Hello everyone, Stefan here. Welcome to the stream. So as you guys have noticed, I've changed the time again. I was streaming at 9 o'clock p.m. in the beginning, and then I switched it to 8:30 for a few weeks. But I realized that it's a little too early actually. It's kind of tricky to stream and have a day job and a normal life. By the time I come home after work, I want to have a little bit of time to have dinner, you know, and spend just a bit of time with my sweet wife. And it's a little tricky, and I don't really like jumping into the stream right away. So I thought just a half an hour more would help a little bit. That's why I changed the time. So hopefully we're going to stick to this 9 p.m. Every other day, Monday, Wednesday, and Friday, and we'll see how it goes. Ideally, I would really like to stream every day, but I'm afraid this is going to take quite a bit of a toll, especially since I want to also work on the other aspect of the game, which is not the graphics, but the but the prototyping and the gameplay, and that in the beginning, I'm gonna have to need some time off stream to do that, and so it'll be probably 2 days, 3 days a week of doing that, then 3 days of streaming. Sorry. So okay. So anyway, tonight we're gonna make a character again, and I figured I would make not a Halloween character. Because everyone is doing Halloween stuff at the moment, so I figured I'm just gonna do the opposite. I'm gonna make a sexy, fun character, and then we'll do a Halloween thing a little later. Maybe it's not Halloween anyway. I guess technically it's the end of the month. So I'm gonna make Jessica Rabbit. I think that would be fun. We'll see. And I know that technically she's not a real character in the sense of like a real flesh and blood person, but you know, she's got so much character that she's hard to pass, especially since as you know, in the game I really want to have all those very iconic characters that people recognize from you know, classic, inspired by classic movies, the issue is since I'm very focused on the 80s and earlier, when you're looking for very iconic female characters, then you realize that there are very few of them compared to their male counterparts, which is a shame really, but that's just the way it is. It's kind of a reflection of the time, the 80s, and before that it was very much of a still a male-dominated entertainment industry. It still is, I think, for sure, but maybe to a less extent now. And you can definitely see a lot more very good, strong female leads now. Studios betting on a full-on female lead to carry an entire movie or franchise, which was not really. And even then, now I think it's still less than male actors. But in the 80s and before that, forget about it. It was very, very unusual. So anyway, that's unfortunate. But the because I really want to try and make as many interesting female characters as I can for the game. All sorts of things. Male, female, human. You know, robots, zombies, creatures, anything that strikes the imagination or remind people of the movies they liked, you know, in those times. Anyway, so that's why I think Jessica Rabbit definitely deserves a spot there in the roster, for many reasons, really. Yeah, she's such a fan character. So I assume most of you guys have seen the film. It was called Who Framed Roger Rabbit. It was a Robert Zemeckis movie. Came out in June, I think, of 1988. So still in the 80s. And it was based on a novel, actually. Again, like many Hollywood blockbusters, based on a 1981 novel by Gary Wolf, which is called not "Who Framed Roger Rabbit," but "Who Censored Roger Rabbit." And in the book was actually quite different. I was reading about it. I haven't read it, but I was kind of trying to read a little bit about it. And the characters in the book are not tuned. It's set in the present time, first of all, like in the 80s, and not in the Hollywood of the 40s. And then the characters are more like comic strip characters, you know, like your underground comic strips. So they're not technically tunes from animated features like they did in the 40s in the film. But I think to transpose this in the 40s, in the Hollywood of the 40s, I think it was a genius move from the scriptwriter, whoever wrote it. It definitely worked really well. And it's interesting actually, because the author years on later he wrote the sequel to his book, and it's called "Who Plugged Roger Rabbit." And but it was based entirely on the world as it was set in the movie. So he completely disregarded what he had written in the first place and completely embraced what Zemeckis had done in the film. I think what I really like about that film too is that I think this is really Zemeckis very much, again, I think striking a really nice balance between comedy, action, and a very interesting and new way, very clever way of using, and very bold actually, very bold way of using special effects. Before that, he had done Back to the Future, who that was also using a lot of special effects, but very much effects at the service of the story, not something that would be like. Something that was a kind of an interesting way of using effects for a comedy. And then he did Roger Rabbit, which was really very much a breakthrough at the time. I remember the same thing, news segment of you know, telling about how they had integrated perfectly those toon characters in a real world and how they had them interact with real humans. Obviously, now you look at this and it's a little... it sounds a little over the top, you know, like, of course you can integrate those, and just, you know, just says it's really not that big of a deal. But at the time in 1988, no one had ever seen that before, you know. And then Zemeckis did it again in Forrest Gump, like I was mentioning last time when we did the Forrest Gump, this character, using the VFX to put Tom Hanks back into footage that was filmed in the 60s alongside Nixon and Kennedy and famous figures of that time. So definitely, I think Zemeckis has his own way of approaching VFX and marrying with comedy that is very, very successful. So I think for this, it was very quite remarkable film. And it's hilarious. It's really, I love it. I think this film is so much fun, and the cast is really good too. I think Bob Hoskins playing Eddie Valiant, the detective, I think was perfect. I could not have imagined a better choice. He was so good in it, and but I mean, Bob Hoskins is such a special actor too. If you've seen him in there's one role you have to see him into. It's when he's playing that character, the plumber in Brazil from Terry Gilliam, 1981. This is absolutely, is it 81? No, 80, can't remember. But the Brazil from Terry Gilliam. And there's this scene where the main character, what's his name? He calls the plumbers because he has an issue with his you know, his like pipes in his apartment, and it's this really dystopic future, and then the those two plumbers arrive, and one of them is played by Bob Hoskins, and they can't really do anything unless they have the form 27B-6, which is it's just a great scene, really, and a great character. Anyway, very very cool movie. It was also based on the classic film noir of the 40s, and I think that's why it really worked, especially when I'll talk about Jessica Rabbit in a minute, but the way you see all those iconic characters, you know, the PI, the femme fatale, the crook, and the bookmaker, or whatnot, all those, you know, classic sort of archetypes of film noir, they made that work really well. And the films that are very much, I think, an inspiration to Roger Rabbit were something like The Maltese Falcon with Humphrey Bogart from John Huston in 1941, and then The Big Sleep from Howard Hawks in 1946, with also featuring Humphrey Bogart in the role of Raymond Chandler, the famous private detective. Lauren Bacall was in it too. Very, very, if you're looking for two classic, like, top film noir of the 40s, The Maltese Falcon and The Big Sleep. Those are the two that you need to see. But as to Jessica, they had a lot of fun with her, definitely. I read a little bit about that, some of the anecdotes at the time and the animators. I mean, you can imagine how much fun an animator who's shackled 10 hours a day, 10 to 12 hours a day on a drawing board, needs some kind of release, you know, and anything goes. And a super sexy female character is definitely something that an animator would have fun with, you know, at the time. So I can totally relate to that for sure, you know, as a male artist at least. But the funny thing is that they actually changed her in the film compared to the book. In the book, she was very much more of a, not evil, but definitely a more mischievous a character that would betray Roger Rabbit for good, you know, much more of a femme fatale, like this, you know, the based on the classic French expression, which literally means a lethal woman. Lethal woman. So when you think of it, you know, femme fatale, this is what it means. She was very much more like this, because but in the film they changed her, and she's actually she looks like, when you know, first dance scene, when she comes in and she performs the song, you can, the way she plays with the audience and teases them, you are totally under the impression that she's gonna be trouble, you know. It turns out that she's actually quite faithful to Roger Rabbit. She was kind of forced to cheat on him, you know, at some point, by the exec of the studio and all the stuff that happens. But you can tell that she genuinely loves her husband Roger Rabbit, which is hilarious, you know, which makes her even more interesting as a character. Because she really breaks from the mold of at some point of what she was supposed to be. And the famous line that she has when she says, what is it? "I'm not bad, Mr. Valiant, I'm just drawn that way." This is a line that was in the original book, because she tries to make him think that she's not bad, but she is. But in the film, actually, she isn't. So it's a fun little nod that they had there. And the inspirations for the character are multiple. I think the main one to me was, I think it's obvious that she was inspired from the Little Red Riding Hood from Tex Avery. In 1943, there was a very, very famous cartoon that came out, when actually under the censorship cut because some scenes were deemed too a little too suggestive, too adult for what was considered a cartoon at the time and for kids, you know. And that cartoon, Tex Avery 1943, was called Red Rod Riding Hood, which was a little making fun with the title of the little Red Riding Hood, and at the same time the Red Hot, which is red hot as the car, but also as the girl, because the wolf in there as the a red hood on his car. If you remember that super long car when he comes to pick her up at the club, and that wolf was from Dumbhounded. It was the very first Droopy cartoon. If you remember the dog Droopy, his very first cartoon, there was a wolf in it. And that wolf was then in Red Rod Riding Hood. Let me try and find a picture for you, because I wonder if so the whole sexy sort of performer in the red dress, the strapless dress, sorry, was definitely something that was from this writing. So I'm gonna red. I'm gonna write. Okay, I got it. So that's the character. You know her. You've seen her. And she was created in 1943, and that's the famous scene when the wolf gets all crazy and hits the table and his eyes pop out of his of his skull and like this and all that kind of stuff. I mean, this is all very much, and you can tell that the club scene in Who Framed Roger Rabbit are definitely based on this, so she was the main inspiration, I think. And but also the animators, they used some other characters, like real characters, like I think, to me, they don't, I'm not sure they mention it anywhere, but I'm pretty sure that they inspired from Rita Hayworth in Gilda. Let me see. And so this is a very, like, super famous iconic scene from that film Gilda. This film was, I think it was 1946. And there you go. So I don't know, that's the one, the strapless dress. Let's see. My internet will probably crap the bed. Seems like it's going. You won't have the sound, but it's okay. We're just gonna browse through real quick. So there you go. So that's Gilda, Rita Hayworth, and that whole scene, like, made a lot of heads turn at the time. I can tell you that she became an instant sex symbol after that. Huge influence for future generations of female performers, sex symbols, and whatnot, you know. But you see, she has also a lot of humor about her performance, and I think that's what really made it click and work. And so the long gloves and the strapless dress were, I think, definitely director. That's John Glenn right there. It was a very, very famous inspiration for, in my opinion, for, and she was redhead too, for that girl, definitely. And also Lauren Bacall was probably Lauren Bacall more for the fact that she was a very strong woman. She wouldn't take any crap from any man, and you can see that in The Big Sleep. I think those are very much the influences for that character. So Jessica, she's kind of a mix of all this, I think. She became also an instant sex symbol. Actually, she even made the cover of Playboy that very same year, 1988, in November issue. They had a model. I think she was called Lauren Richman, I think. And she was playmate. She was some kind of playmate, and they shot her for the cover naked, and then they put they drew. They had an artist drew the Jessica Rabbit outfit on top of her, and that was the cover for Playboy. It's a very, very fun cover. What I really like about what they did with Jessica, if you remember when she has that first scene and Betty Boop, like, poor girl, she's there, she's all black and white, you know, she doesn't have any color, she's all tiny, and you can tell that she knows Eddie Valiant very well, and they have a little chat, and then she says something like, oh, you know, she's a new girl, you know, and there's no place for black and white now, they all want color. And that was a really good, very clever way of talking about the transition from black and white to color that happened at the time in Hollywood in the 40s, you know. At that time, the first color stock started to hit, and there was a lot of talk about what it meant for black and white and where cinema would go, and then by the time the 50s were there, Alfred Hitchcock had totally embraced color, and like so many other famous directors, and no one would ever go back, you know. So that was a big deal, and they played with the idea at the same time of, you know, actors not being in the, you know, being sort of having a very short lifetime in Hollywood, you know, and being easily replaced by new, harder, more interesting, more trendy people. But also the technology transition was sort of embedded into the same idea. Actually, Hollywood had two hard transitions like this. One was the passage to color, and another one was the passage from silent to sound. And this was decimated the entire industry, at least in the actors, because what happened is that most very famous actors, like, I'm talking about superstars at the time, I'm trying to find a name, but you know, like, imagine someone of the caliber of Meryl Streep, Robert De Niro, you know, people of that magnitude, Clint Eastwood, would be all of them pretty much gone overnight in a matter of a month. And the reason why is because they only played silent, so no one cared about what their voice was. But when they came into, they started recording them, most of them had really weird voices, and people were not used to their voices, and they couldn't really act. They acted with their body, but they had no training into you know, real acting with the voices, and so most of them couldn't even act, or had weird voices or lisps or whatnot, you know. And so 90% of the actors that were superstars really during the silent era just disappeared, you know. There's a beautiful French movie actually about this called The Artist that you have to watch. It's a fantastic movie, won the Academy Award. I was so glad for this guy. I can't remember the name. French director has a name that I can't even pronounce because it's so complicated, even for French people. Let me look it up real quick, because this is really a film that you guys have to watch. It's absolutely beautiful, and it's the same idea. It talks about and a very famous actor in the that has sort of like the look and feel of Errol Flynn, He's a super famous, you know, he's a superstar, and all of a sudden it's Michel Azanavicius. So yeah, don't quote me on that, but The Artist, 2011 French movie, really really fantastic, you have to watch this. And then and that's there's a scene notably where the guy becomes a little crazy, and then it's a totally silent scene, and then and the film is black and white, 4:3, like at the time, and it's silent for the most part. So it's it is something that is just amazing. You would never think that a silent movie, black and white, in a square format could just maintain your interest. But believe me, if you give it a shot, you'll see. So well, I took a wide tangent there, but I think it was worth it, worth mentioning for sure. Anyway, so yeah, I think we'll do our girl here, sort of cartoon Rita Hayworth. Kathleen Turner was voicing her in the film, but for some reason she was uncredited. I don't know why they forgot her in the credits, so it's very bizarre. I'm not sure. I think I'm gonna do. So I have already did her, made her as a very small character. Obviously, you know, I think we're gonna gain in sexiness by having her a little bigger. But still worth looking at. But that's her. Two different poses that I did there for the fun. I wasn't sure about the leg. But you know what? I think I'm gonna take her there and grow her up at the new size, and we'll go from there. Not necessarily because I want to keep the pose or everything, but I kind of like the colors. So the dress in that scene, the whole sequin, beautiful sequin dress, looks pink, you know, like hot pink, which I really like for her. But especially because it's more of a difference between her dress and the color of her hair. But in the film, after that, when she walks around and she seems to have the same dress because it's exactly the same cut and everything's strapless, and the she has the gloves and everything, but then the dress looks red, really pure red, and doesn't have any sequin on it. I think the sequin is probably because they probably wanted her to look maybe a little less you know, sort of like dressed for an evening or so. But but I think it was kind of I couldn't really wrap my head around that choice. The fact that the dress looks the same, but looks kind of not. The sequins are gone. The costume's different. In other scenes of her, and actually, when she's represented most of the time, she doesn't look like she's having a. See, so that's a figure that they did, but this the dress is definitely red, so that's kind of like her normal, you know, look there. That's from the movie, but see, no sequin, and so I think they just assume that under the lighting of the, you know, the club, she looked more pink. It just took that license. Doesn't really make any sense. But I like that color, so I may just use this palette for her, you know. We'll see. Where is she? Where are you, Jessica? There. I'm just gonna take this one. Doesn't really matter. In so size for women, usually around 60. I mean, she's pretty, I assume that she's pretty tall, you know, she's not a short woman, so I'm gonna say 58 maybe. What about her? How tall? 59. We're gonna say 59, or even 60. I think we can go even 60 probably. Yeah, and then we'll see. Let's take this and we'll say, oops, we'll say 60. Oh, twice as much. Perfect. 20 by 60. Boom. Okay, bring our bag. Gonna delete for that. Okay. So, oh, wait a minute. Nope, that doesn't sound right. Did I copy this? Oh, there you go. Okay, just got. We have so when she at the time when the so the animators, you know, they like to have fun and do some silly jokes and things, and I think it'll be a little small on that size, but that may be fine. We'll see. So the animators, what they did, they hid a certain frame in the thing. So there's a scene where she gets, they're in the car, you know, in the toon car, and she's there with Eddie Valiant, and they chase after after the bad toons, and they go to Toontown, and they have an accident, and she gets, you know, thrown out of the car. And so the rumor was that at some point in that sort of animation cycle, her dress opens up, and then for a couple of frames, you realize that Jessica Rabbit doesn't wear any panties. So yeah, and so obviously, as soon as that rumor came out, everyone wanted to see the shot, you know, the frame or the couple of frames, and you couldn't really you couldn't see it at 24 frames per second, which is the normal rate of film. Definitely not in video. You couldn't see it. It was very hard to pause on a certain frame in video, you know, in a VHS. It was VHS at the time. So people tried to pause, you know, and they couldn't, and it was all scrambled, and they couldn't get it. But then the Laserdisc came out. I'm gonna stop painting. The Laserdisc came out, and so sure enough, the Laserdisc sold out almost instantaneously because of that famous legend. That's because people wanted to see the shot, you know, and they knew that they could pause and frame by frame the film. So they were like, if this exists somewhere, there's no way we're gonna miss it. And it turns out it was true. It was true. You can actually see something that you should not see. I don't know what the animators thought when they did that, but anyway, it's their character. It was their choice. It's funny, you know. And obviously, I looked it up. Obviously. Because I wanted to know. I was dying of curiosity. And I can tell you that it's very underwhelming. So don't waste your time too much. Yes, there's definitely something going on. But no, it's not what you think. It's pretty, it's very tame. And it's very blurry and whatever. So, you know, it's fine. But anyway, the Laserdisc sold out in a matter of hours because of that. Of that story. So look it up. If you want the perfect search string for this, it has to be, I think, Jessica Rabbit crotch shot. Not the best, but that's how people call it. So there you go. There you have it. Now you know everything that you have to know about Jessica Rabbit. Even the things that you should know. So Okay, so back to the post. I got those references actually because I thought they were really nice and pretty. I absolutely love this pose. I think this pose is beautiful. There is so much character. So this is when she walks in from behind the curtain, and makes her famous grand entrance before as she's gonna perform the song. And this is a little more plain, she's facing straight, and it's just a cycle, really. This is another frame of that cycle, but you can tell how they played the swing of the shoulders back and forth. This shoulder is so much in the front compared to this one, because obviously they wanted to play the chest going back and forth, like a pendulum. So they've really pushed her personality as far as they could, and this pose I think is great too. I really like that top. I like this a lot because this has a lot of motion to it. She very much feels like in motion, and I like how the hair kind of appears underneath the body, and I really like the leg there, or this leg. I'm not a too much of a fan of that leg. I think it's a little noodly, and it's not very strong. I feel the nice leg there, this leg is nice, so it's a nice cut with the dress. So I think we're gonna definitely do this for the bottom, and I think we're gonna probably Frankenstein her a little bit, if you will, because I really like that. I like this one a lot because same thing. We have the shoulders, the angle in the shoulders, very important. But I think in this pose, she feels so strong in terms of like she looks like a very strong woman. She doesn't look like she's teasing so much as she is looking down on you. Like you're just nothing. And she's got this. This strong sort of like a confidence. That's the word I was looking for. She looks super confident, and I think that really suits her in this one too. So we'll see. Maybe we'll do this, or maybe we'll do that. I think this I really like. It's almost like imagine we take this body. We're gonna Frankenstein her really quickly. Sorry, just guess. It's not gonna be very nice, but no pixel wash connected already. Okay, just get hold on. Believe in us. It's just a quick test. But I kind of like that, because then we can play the angle in the torso, we can play the hips and the dress, and so all of that works pretty well. So we'll end up probably somewhere in between. So I think so far I'm just gonna I think I'm gonna try and get this. I like the lighter color for her. Let me see. Just wanna double check what kind of color I have for our friend here. Sonia. Yeah. So see Sonia there, she's very yellow. So this is something that I always do, depending on the outfit of the character. I tend to color the skin a little bit different so that it fits a little better with the character. So a character that has more of a cooler shade, I will have the skin a little bit more, maybe a little more yellow, and someone who's a bit warmer, then maybe the skin would be a little more pink, a little bit more red, and I tend to do that a lot. So I never, I'm that's why I'm never quite consistent with color, and values in skin. I try to make them work for that specific character. And what I really like here is how cool she is. By cool, I mean look at the skin. It's very pink, I don't think we'd go that far, but because this is obviously a lighting that's supposed to be like the sort of bluish lighting from the club, more like she's under a spotlight, and the spotlight is very cool, it's very blue, so that's why. And that's why I think the dress also gets this pink color. But I won't go that far, but I still think that this color doesn't quite work as a skin tone that size. She looks like she has a tan, and she's more pale skin, you know, like here. But this good color, I think, something in there. So it's almost like we could do this, take this, you know. We'll show you. I've showed you this trick before. Filter. Yes, filter, blur. And then you go, what the hell, average. Sorry, some wrong layer. Blur, average. Now we have an average color. It's a little darker than it should be, but, you know, if it's too dark, because it's averaging this, that's a little shadow, to this, then we can either take a smaller portion. Oh, really? Sorry. Like this. That's not too bad. Or we can take use a different filter. Something like blur, surface blur, and play with it. Again, on the wrong layer. And then we can play with it, you know, a bit. And so we have about an average. So now we can pick that color. I think we'll go a little lighter. But this probably won't work for what we need. But I'm just gonna change it a little bit. See how very different. It's funny how dark this looks if you take this and then you know, surprisingly dark, you know, and this looks very light, right, compared to here. And really this is because of the surrounding colors. Everything is like quite dark around, and that's why you really have to always be very careful with picking colors. Picking colors is not necessarily the right way of doing things, because you when you pick color, you don't take into, you just pick a very it's a very it's an information that is out of context that you put into a different context that is here, which is like super bright environment, you know. So that's why we need to, picking a color is not necessarily the right thing to do, but it can give you an interesting starting point, you know. But here with me, I'm used to colors enough that I can play with my gut a little bit. I think we're gonna end up probably quite light around here. I'm gonna keep it around the red side more than the yellow. Maybe I'll be completely out of it, but I think we're gonna do something like this, and we'll see eventually. It's a bit too. Probably a bit too bright. Go to, and we're gonna saturate. I think maybe we'll end up somewhere there, and we'll see. You know, we'll see as we go. It's not a big deal. So let's try and make this. I think I have to swap her. Actually, I'm gonna keep the leg and. Just gonna swap this because I want to make sure that I follow the same. Oops. Boom. Okay. So really, what I want to get is this, you know. One of the most important thing really is this. That angle. So we really need to get, I think we need to get this, right? And then we need to get that. Let me pick another color. We need to get this and the kink here. on the wa in the waist, we need to get that, the nice curve there, you know, going from here, if we can. And that would be a good start. So again, I think I mentioned this, and you see they've overdone quite a bit, but sexy pose, in interesting pose generally. Sometimes you're just sexy, but kind of like with a lot of attitude, you try to counterbalance hips to shoulders. So you do this, and girls, they know that when they pose, they for magazines and stuff, they know that stuff by heart, you know. So they always do that this way. This way, see, that's how you're supposed to do it. So you can play with that when you're posing a character. Oops. Okay, back to it. So we're gonna try and get this. So now we have more polygons for polygons. More. Pixels for this, which will be a very good. I'm gonna try and get this, but I'm a little worried that look weird at this side. It look like the dress isn't finished or something, you know. Not sure we can get this, but we'll see what we can get. I'm gonna play the shadow of the breast, you know, because if you want them to look it's kind of a, maybe I should have put on the mature flag for this stream, I guess, but I guess not, right? It's fine, we're just having fun here. It's nothing terrible, right? We all know what this is. It's good fun. Interesting story about Rita Hayworth, and that's why I think she also was an influence for that character. So Rita Hayworth in Gilda, she was in that film, 1946 movie, you know. And then unfortunately, at the same time, there was a nuclear. The U.S. were conducting a lot of nuclear blast tests, you know, and because it was the Cold War, you know, the Cold War was starting, and they wanted to keep going with their military exercise, and in particular the atomic bomb. And so in 1946 there was it was the second stage of the second phase of nuclear atomic bomb nuclear tests, and it was called Operation Crossroads, if I remember well, and that was the direct continuation of the Trinity test. It was a continuation of the Manhattan Project, which was starting in the 40s during the war. Because Einstein and a bunch of other scientists had warned the U.S. that the Germans were working on an atomic bomb, and so the Americans were very worried, you know, that they could get it first. So they scrambled all their scientists and said, we need this, we need the bomb, you know, before the Germans. They had no intention of using it, but they sure wanted this to be, they wanted to be the first to get it, just in case, you know, even as a deterrent, you know, and so anyway, you must wonder what's the relationship with Jessica Rabbit. Well, there is one, because in 1945, July, the 3rd of July, I think they detonated in the New Mexico desert. It was a Project Trinity, it was called. They detonated a bomb they called the Gadget. It was the very first atomic bomb that was detonated in the world, and it was in the New Mexico desert, in a place that they nicknamed Trinity. And then and they liked the military, they liked to nickname their stuff. So they call that the Gadget, the very first bomb. It was a plutonium-based bomb. I think it was around 15 kiloton, which is basically means that it's the equivalent of 15,000 tons of TNT blasting at in one single blast. And then unfortunately, we know what happened in August. First, it was August 3 of 1945. The first live uranium bomb this time was dropped over the Japanese city of Hiroshima. It was a 15 kiloton bomb as well, and it was dropped from a B-29 bomber, the Enola Gay. It was flown by Colonel Tibbets, and famous guy who later on would say that he would do it again every single time, which was controversial, but not that much, interestingly. And anyway, so and then the third 3 days later, so that was August 6th. 3 days later, August 9th, they dropped another bomb on Nagasaki. This one much stronger, much more efficient, and it was again a plutonium-based bomb. And then from another B-29 called the Boxcar. And so anyway, those bombs, they had also names. The first one was nicknamed Little Boy, and the second one was named Fat Man. That's how they call him. And they were supposed to have a third bomb that they had already planned to drop on Japan again a few days later. I think they wanted to drop it on the 12 or something. But then in the meantime, it was so frightening and so like unimaginable that the Japanese surrendered very quickly after that, and they didn't have to drop the third bomb. But the third bomb was already in the Philippines or somewhere, I think, in maybe in Iwo Jima. I think that's where they flew out. Was all The bomb was already there, and they were ready to drop it. So thank God that the Japanese decided to surrender. Anyway, so back to our story, because there's a point to all this. I kind of go on a tangent again. The point is, almost a year, directly a year later, the American, they were like, well, we're gonna make more tests now, and so they launched another project called Operation Crossroads. In this operation, they dropped several other bombs on, and that this time it was in the Pacific, in the Bikini Atoll. That's where they dropped the bombs. They relocated all the people first, which were not happy about that, as you can imagine. And then they blasted their atoll, the Bikini Atoll. And the very first bomb that they used, it was then the fourth nuclear device ever detonated on Earth by humans. This bomb, they called it Gilda. And because the film had just came out and it was a massive success, Gilda was everywhere, and Rita Hayworth was such a sex symbol. And military being military and being essentially a bunch of boys, they decided that it would be a really good idea to name their new bombshell, and that was the joke, Gilda. So someone had the brilliant idea of like they did in the back in the days in the painting the noses of the bombers with, pinups and stuff like that, which I don't have a problem with because I can understand that, they were young guys and they went essentially to death for the most part. And so the last thing they wanted to see on their nose of the bomber is something not fun, So they definitely thought that a sexy girl would bring them luck and maybe bring them back home and, and they had all their little superstitions. So I can understand that. However, the bombs named after, actresses and stuff. I mean, I guess they meant that as a compliment. So they called her. They put a photo of Rita Hayworth on the bomb, and then someone painted Gilda and you drop that on the atoll. In I think it was the 1st of July 1946. But they meant this as a compliment, but I can tell you that Rita Hayworth didn't take that as a compliment for one bit. She hated it, and apparently she went into a rage. She was furious. She wanted to go to Washington and have a hold a press conference over there, saying that the military are a bunch of idiots and all of that. But her husband at the time was what's his name? Orson Welles, famous Orson Welles. He said he convinced her that it was a bad idea because she had like a very, very good career. She was on everyone's mouth, and then he told her that she was gonna commit career suicide because there was a lot of anti-communist climate at the time, the Cold War, it was starting, all of that. So it was definitely not a time to be seen as unpatriotic for an actress, So he told her, look, this is not a publicity stunt from Columbia, because she thought that it was an idea that one of the execs at Columbia had to that he suggested that to the military. But it wasn't the case. They just came up with that because they just loved her, and so when she knew that it wasn't a publicity stunt, and that she realized that Orson Welles was probably right, and it was quite a bad idea to try and make a big deal out of it. So she eventually see she settled down and let it go, But it's an interesting story. Find it, and it kind of gives you a feel for who she was. Definitely not the timid kind of actress that you can have do whatever you want. She was very much in charge, and she had a very strong opinion about things. Good for her. But yeah, what a bunch of idiots. I can't believe that they named an atomic bomb after a woman. That was such a poor choice. But it's a different time. It was a different time, and things were different, definitely. Not that not necessarily an excuse, but they certainly I don't think that that the people who made that call, they very much realized what was going on, and they were like, oh, it's fun, whatever. But I think if you do this now, you'd hear it quite a bit, I think. Makes me think when they started changing the hurricane, because we have famous hurricanes now, and blasting the East Coast, unfortunately for them again. Called Michael, and I remember when all hurricanes were female names, and women complaining, or rightly so. Why is it that they always have female names? And then they changed that. But at the time, yeah, a lot of weapons and a lot of destruction was carrying a lot of humor. They in innuendo, very, very weird mix, but I guess it's very much human nature. trying to get this. I'm not. So there's a. So here's the issue with her. I think is the thickness of the arms. I really like the super tiny ends. That's what's really fun about her. She has like tiny, tiny, tiny feet and super tiny hands. Minuscule, really, really tiny, much smaller than they should be. But it made her very much like the sort of like the ultimate male fantasy. Big where male usually like, and very small otherwise, and fragile and delicate. So they certainly knew what they were doing there, the animators. This hand is, so it's at this it's surprisingly not that much easier actually, compared to her small size, because especially for leg, I feel like 1 pixel is too much or not enough. I would like to get this nice curve there, like from the thigh, and then there's a little kink at the knee, and then a nice curve on the fleshy part of the shin there. So let's try and get this. I think I need a stronger cut there, probably. It's gonna be a bit tricky to get that right, I think. I really want to get a super super thin waist too. But again, it has to look right. It can't be just too weird. And I don't have any of the nice curve that I was mentioning. So I definitely need to work that out. So I need to lower that hip, I think, and then bring this up, because this is very much like the butt, and there it's more like the front of the leg. So I think that's where we need to do something. And I wonder if I want to have a little bit of dress underneath, like here. Maybe, but not sure this is gonna look right. Yeah, maybe not. Maybe we'll just have a little bit of a, something. You know what they did? Okay, so this is a really a weird, forgive me, but I think it's funny, so I'm just gonna say, they did something really weird in animation with her, and you'll notice this, and I remember because I saw it, and when I saw it, I was like, I don't know, there's something that's a little funny about her, her butt, but, and it's about the animation. So what they did is, they animated the this is kind of a weird topic, but it's funny and it's interesting. They had boob jiggle, on it, on her, like, because they wanted to convey the the mass, and so, and the physics of it. So they did this, and but what they did is that they animated the physics of the breast in a correct way, which was bouncing when it's supposed to bounce down, when it's supposed to go down, and up when it's supposed to go up. But they animated the butt in reverse. They had it go up when it would be supposed to go down, and vice versa. And the result was that she was like super sexualized this way, because the butt was kind of like, was like counter animated to the breast. She's really funny. So look back at the way she walks, and you'll definitely see that it's a really fun and clever thing that they did there. It doesn't look completely, it doesn't look wrong necessarily, and that's what's funny about it. You just take it for what it is, but it shouldn't be that way, yeah, it's funny. So I'm gonna try and I really would like to try and get this, but I'm a bit worried. So But I'm not gonna be able to pull that off. Just gonna flip her real quick. Yeah, so this is too much. Doesn't look right. Bring this down a bit. Again. And so that's gonna be difficult too, I think. Looks like she's looking this way, and I want her to look this way. Difficult to get the So for this, I think we'll probably have to make quite a bit of we'll have to make some choices. I shouldn't jump around like I'm doing at the moment. You know, I'm not focused on one task. That's not really good, but it's okay. Well, that's me. This is something I'm very, very guilty of doing all the time. I'm onto something, you know, and then I'm like, oh, I need to do this, and then sure enough, few seconds later, I'm doing the head for no particular reason, except that I'm just worried that I'm not gonna get it, so I'm trying to fix it, you know, frantically, and then I keep doing this all around. So it is not something that I recommend you do. Here's the other issue there. If I have hair here, it's very difficult to read. Which is super important, which is that, you know, the curve there. So we may have to drop the as much as I love, and honestly, we don't see her hair there, and they probably did the same thing. Actually, they probably consciously cut the hair a little shorter because they didn't want to cut the nice silhouette, you know, the hourglass silhouette, very important there, thin waist, and you know. And so and then here it reads because it's on the light side, so you see how the animators, they're always trying to think about that stuff, you know. This is against dark and this is against dark, so we still read the curve, and I can guarantee you that this is not a coincidence. I'm pretty sure that they thought about it when they painted it. So we have to make a choice, you know. We can either go hair this way, on the light side, to preserve that, you know, that curve. Or we can go like we did, the other way, but then we leave this alone. I think my instinct would be to go like this for now. We'll see if this works. I just saved a second ago, because I hadn't saved since the beginning. It's very not a good thing to do. The arms, they're gonna have the same issue of being either too big, too fat, or too thin. So we're gonna probably have to use a little bit of anti-aliasing there, as you know, like a half pixel, half value. Still not a big fan of the what I did. I don't think we've don't think I'm coming even close from that nice pose there. So it's okay. We're just gonna go for it, you know. Here, okay, I just realized what's going on. Look at this. And this is the why I keep talking about the importance of masses. You see this, right? And you look at the size of it, and now you look at this and how short that is. This compared to that, and look at me, almost the same, you know. But definitely too, way too much, because that's what makes her interesting there, is that she's kind of like arching back, you know, and you're looking her from a little bit from under, because she's so tall, you know. And so that's why this part of her chest is kind of like, you know, leaning backwards, and there's foreshortening there that you don't have here, and that foreshortening makes this spot small, and that's what I think, that's what we need to get there. We'll see if we can get that, which will give us a little more here to create something interesting, hopefully. So we'll see if that helps even a bit. So you see the difference? Look at this. If you look in here. Oh shit. I lost it. Hold on. Let's do it again. Oh no, we're good. From here to there. See? Completely different feel. This looks almost like it's kind of sagging a little bit. I hate to use that word, but if you know what I mean. In here, it's kind of nice, and you know, she's holding up her, you know, she's got more, she feels more confident there. So I think this is a good move. But we're not there yet. And I think this really shows you again the importance of fighting for how can I put this? Finding, looking at things not just because not just looking, but really looking, analyzing. You know what's going on. You know, and I think. Simple things like this, looking at masses, trying to determine, okay, you know, what's the what's the distance compared to this, how wide is this compared to this arm, you know, how long the head is compared to you know, all of that. If you're putting the conscious effort of doing this, I think you'll see your art improving quite drastically, actually. So I recommend this. You know, I'm gonna use the shadow there to create also a little bit of an angle, so it's not straight, if I can. And we'll probably have to go like this, you know, just suggest something. We're gonna have to be soft in lighting, because that dress is you know, supposed to be quite, you know, soft and light, so we can go to hard contrast. Okay. This is going to be very useful to make sure that we get the kind of round, you know, here. Around feeling. Oops. Not too sure what's the best solution here is. Don't know if I'm going to embrace this this visible part of the body or not. I think it looks great there, but I'm not sure I can pull it off at that size without without it looking a bit weird. And the last thing we want for her is to look weird. She can be too sexy, she can be very fun, she can be beautiful, but she certainly can be weird. Some characters can be weird. It's actually recommended depending on who they are. If they're a little weird, then that's fine, but I don't think that's good for her. Let's try and get a bit of more shoulder here. Not sure this is going to be the right call. I really don't like this arm at all. And also, the funny thing is, in my career, I've had to kind of want to mention this because I think it's funny, and I'm pretty sure it happened in this film as well. I've had the opportunity to design, characters, as a concept artist and whatnot, and I've had to work on various characters and various types of characters, like creatures or non-human, human, all that, different genres, different styles. But the one thing that is that I've always pretty much invariably noticed is if I was to work on a female character, because the game industry was essentially a male-dominated industry, then everyone would have an opinion, like all the guys, all the producers, there would be always someone to tell you, I don't know if this or that, why don't you make her blonde or brunette, or. Because really what happens is that everyone wants their own fantasy, and so it's funny, and then you make a guy and no one cares. You can literally do anything you want, so that's something that I think it's funny, because it happened to me so many times. I was like, here we go again, everyone's gonna tell me something about her. And everyone's super picky, they're like, oh, I don't know if maybe this dress could be a little more like this or that. And you're like, come on, dude, because what's happening. No, that's not right. I'm just gonna check for size real quick. I think she's gonna look tiny. I may have to. Yeah, I'm gonna have to. It's gonna be a tricky one. I think I want to have her just a bigger overall. She looks a little thin and looks different size, you know. Let's bring her. Yeah, especially the arms. I see the arms, at this size it's fine, but compared to her, they don't. And I mean, granted, you know, Saccharinus, you know, she's got the big guns, but I don't know. Her, she's purposely very thick because she's like super strong. We're not gonna do that for Jessica, but I think it can go a little thicker. But on the we're gonna try. We're gonna try it. But I think the way of doing this is to start with the arms, and then we're gonna build everything around. So everything's gonna get bigger, but that's fine because hopefully, if I don't mess up completely, it'll still look like she's got normal arms, so to speak. Because everything will be, you know, changed accordingly. Obviously, this doesn't work here. Like this, probably all right, but this one not. So I'm gonna have to, you know, I think gonna have to go a little wider, and then we're gonna have to go maybe a little taller, just everything just a bit bigger. And it's gonna be a matter of trying to make things work now at this new size without her looking like a bodybuilder, which we don't want either, obviously. So I think here I'm gonna have to have an angle, and that's gonna be the only way to get the right thickness for the arm. In a case like this, sometimes that's the only way, you know. You kind of have to play with that a bit. Oh, poor Jessica. It's not going very well for her at the moment, but hold on. We're doing this. We're not giving up on her. This is really nice what they've done in the lighting there. So just a little bit of the belly, you know, and that it's very nice and clean. It's very difficult to paint lighting in motion, and they did a really amazing job there, I think. So I'm definitely going to steal this, you know, because I can't do better than them. I'm gonna spend, I think, a lot of time with the arms and stuff like this because I wouldn't want them to look like as nice as I can, you know. Here, I think we're gonna have to do some anti-aliasing, probably. Yeah, that's very tricky there. Very tricky. So the cold, I had this very bad cold, and it's a bit better, but it's unfortunately still there. So I'm still low energy, and I apologize in advance for maybe being a little slow and sluggish and generally a bit annoying to hear. I swear I'm doing my best to keep engaged and everything. I think it would be nice to feel a little bit of a waist there as well, and the hip to belly. Same thing, it's here but a little bit there. They didn't do it here, but I think we can afford to do that on ours. Because obviously we're just trying to make her as good as we can, and it's not necessarily exactly the same. We're not dealing with the same thing exactly, so I think it's fine. Still a bit crap overall, but we're on it, we're working, so we'll still hope. We need to keep the hope alive. That's what matters. Maybe we'll change the hair a little bit and have fun with having suggesting a little bit of a something like a big clump or something, but for now just a mass doesn't. So let me kill this entirely, because sometimes I just want to look at the upper body for now. It's just gonna be hard to do. Stopping a bit. Just trying to really look at things. I wish I could get this shoulder. I wish I could see the bottom of this, but I think it's probably the same as this. Still fighting with the pose, which is fine, which is fine. This is a tricky pose, and this is generally, I mean, you know, female characters, they're difficult because it's all like. Like especially that kind of like character, it's like all curves and, you know, perfect lines, and it's not really, there's not much, you know, kind of interesting detail or anything. So if you mess up the lines and the proportions just a tiny bit, you're already screwed. So you really need to put a lot of effort into this, and it can be it can be quite frustrating, you know, to get that. But if you're not doing it, then you're just gonna mess it up, and she'll never look right. So it's just the way it is, you know. We just have to do the best we can and keep going until. Until finally it clicks, you know. So this is getting a bit better. So we're starting there to feel it. I start to feel the character a little bit more. And it's interesting how sometimes you just have to give yourself a little bit of slack, you know, and just, you know, spend a bit of, like, understand that it's a tricky thing. It's not trivial, you know. So if you can't get it, then I think it's easy to feel like you're not worth anything. But I think realizing that you're dealing with something that's a little subtle and complex, then sometimes it helps a little bit, you know. So I think I'm gonna skip on the this head and go for something a little simpler and more straight, because this is too hard. I don't think I can rebrand this very properly, and I think it's gonna look weird not to have a neck. Here it's nice, but I feel like we're gonna need to feel a little bit of a neck, because like women, especially I feel like the neck in women is very important, you know. Kind of a long, thin neck is always more elegant than a stubby one, you know, and a short one. So in that case, I think it doesn't really serve us to try and go for. So I think we're gonna make a neck and see if that helps. And I think you can tell already how much more elegant she looks right there, just because we gave her a bit of a neck. So I think it's definitely worth doing. Yeah, I think I like this better with the neck. Not that, you know, she looks fantastic, but definitely a bit better, I think. And we're gonna try to get this sort of curve there, you know, like that you can see here or there. You know, this is very interesting, you know. So let's see if there's any way to get some of that. This is getting more interesting now. Would love to be able to render the you know, half the face covered, but I think it's just something that might be. Oh, well, actually, this is not bad. Yeah, this is not too bad. It's kind of interesting. Maybe we can also. Turn her head a bit. Might be interesting. Like, you know, she's looking the side as she's moving. No, I'm not a huge fan of that. Wonder if, okay, hold on. Wonder if I need to suggest in her case just a bit of mouth in one eye. It's gonna be really hard to get anything that doesn't look really weird, but we're gonna give it a quick shot. Just because I don't wanna stay away from any sort of possibility. What's going on? Look at this. It's really not good, but it's fine. We're just experimenting. I have the suspicion that this can be already done, but still want to see what I can do. No, I don't think we'll put an eye there. Gonna leave our featureless. Because I never mind, I think it's I don't, even though she is a cartoon, I don't want her to look like a silly caricature, you know? So that's why I'm perfectly happy leaving her without any features. Because I think then she looks more like you make your own face, you know, you don't really have to see it, and then it's just fine. As long as we understand the general shape of the head. That's getting better. I think head is too high. I'm gonna bring this down. And I wish I could really get this. This hair there, very hard. Just miss some pixels there. Thank you. The long hair is very important though. But I want, like I said, I want to kill this. I still think we could to go with a bit more neck even maybe. Let's see. Ah, it's that 1 pixel is too much. Such a shame. This is interesting. Suggesting the, I feel like if we suggest the ear there, then she looks like she's facing us. Right, I think this is way better. And I think if we don't want her to look like she's looking away, then we need the hair to be fairly even on both sides. From here. Let's see. Okay, hold on. I'm gonna try and copy it on another layer. Just wanna turn her head. Oops. Yeah. Just to see. No. Hold on. Okay, turn. See if we can play the same idea there. Maybe this is better. Yes, this is better. It's not quite right, but it's better, I think. Oh yeah, I like this better too. So see, so one of the things is bringing back some lighting in there. To me, it makes looks like there's less shadowing from. If there's less shadow from the neck there, it means that she's looking more up because if she's looking down. The shadow created by her neck would sort of creep down And but so this is more like looking up, think. That's also a bit better, more in line with character. Okay, we got it. Whew, finally. Yeah, this is way better. This is finally getting somewhere after like 6 hours. Yeah, I think we're in better shape now. Would like to have this curve, you know. It's really difficult. Let's see if we can do that. Think it's better a little lower. Yes. So yeah, Jessica, she's giving us a run for our money there. But we're getting her. I think we're slowly getting her. I'm a bit more confident that I was a little earlier. Okay. Right. So I think upper body not too bad. I'll come back on this eventually. But I think I want to try and solve, see where we were before. Yes, this is better. We'll turn her so we can compare apples to apples. Oh yeah, new head is 100 times better. So there you go. So we commit to this. Now we got our. So here, same thing. Here, I'm gonna have to thicken her legs quite a bit. Because otherwise, I had to thicken everything up so that she looks more in line with, the other people. I like that she's very tall, actually. Maybe a bit much, but we'll see. So I had to thicken her a bit. She looks more in line with everyone else, more in line with her, or her. I think now we're getting there. But so the unfortunate consequence of that is that I have to thicken the lower leg as well, maybe even more the thigh. I don't necessarily like to do this, but it's just a consequence of everything, and it's just the way it is. And again, it's just, in the end, it's an interpretation. We can't really, but I think it would be nice to try and get this, but I don't know how that's gonna be. It's gonna be tricky. Gonna be one of those where, oops, oh, the dress cuts really, really clean there, you know. I wonder if that's what we want to do. Cuts a good portion of the leg. Yeah, I think that's better. Also, we want this line to go this way, not that way, you know. So this is a bit better. Yeah, so that's nicer. It's all about revealing just enough, but not too much, you know? It's all about that. Here we want to feel the leg there, so we'll use the lighting for that. That's more interesting. And here, it's going to be a case where we need the anti-aliasing, because otherwise it's just not smooth enough. Sorry, hold on. Just gonna do a little thing here. Okay, back to it. So she has this tiny shoes that I can't even remember seeing in the I know that they're super you know, high heels, obviously very thin. I can't remember too much what they look, but I think you can barely see them anyway. So we're just gonna take a little color there and suggest a little shoe. I think we need to be extremely tiny, you know, and delicate with that. Trying to find a solution to this problem. Very tricky one. Going to turn this around. Yes. You know what we could do? I feel like we could do a little bit of, take a bit of liberty there and suggest a little strap there on the leg. I think that's going to help separating the foot from the rest of the leg. And I think it's probably all right, but then we'd need some kind of color. Maybe we can play with this, you know. And I know it's not her necessarily, but I think this helps a lot for the leg, you know, makes her way more feminine having that little strap there for the foot. So I think I kind of like that idea. Right, I think we can probably do that. And then we'd have the other foot would be kind of like more in shadow. I'm just gonna copy this one and then put it under. And then we're gonna try and find a position that would be interesting because we really want a motion, you know, like the swag. You know, she's walking and she's kind of like swaying her hips. So there's a lot of difference between the two feet where they are, you know. I'm gonna see if we can do that a bit. Of course, I'd like to feel the perspective in the foot, but that might be difficult. Pretty tricky to get there. It's really we're really missing a pixel there. Very tricky. Dress to dress is good to separate the 2 feet, but hold on. Why did they do that? Yeah, but we're in a different case, I think, now. So I kind of have to figure that out myself. Me, also, I'm gonna go a little, darker there. Just see, I'm gonna push the saturation. I'm gonna put a bit more blue in it. And red. We wanted this to be the background foot, you know. It's probably a little too dark. Trying to find the proper. Yeah, I think that might be fine. Let me go back to 2 feet the same. I don't know. Maybe it could do that, but I think I'm gonna suggest that this part of the dress is probably shadowing the foot, and then maybe just try something. Maybe the bottom of the foot is actually still in light, you know? Yeah, something like this. Gonna go even a little bit brighter for the skin in general. Am I painting anything? Yep. Just a bit brighter. Convinced about the shoe, how to render this properly. Bear with me. We'll refine some way at some point. Okay. I'm not too happy with that. I think I'll see. So this, okay. So obviously doing this is a bit extreme, you know. It looks like we got a massive curve there, but at the same time there looks a little straight, like a stick, you know. So I think if we do this and we thicken a bit the foot, let me commit to this. I think maybe there's a sweet spot somewhere that we can find, and we'll have to go a little more there too. But that might be fine too. And that's what I was saying when I was mentioning that eventually all proportions may need to change a little bit. And that's why, that's because, you know, one thing leads to another, and you have to find that spot, you know, where you feel comfortable. And I think you know, maybe something like this is reasonable. Reasonable. And also, what we can do is let's try this. I'm not sure that's appropriate for her, but one thing we could do is just darken a bit the this area, or lighten the thigh. We'll see. You know, it's the usual trick of suggesting a little bit of a bend in the knee. And so there's this part of the leg receives a little less light. So we'll see if this works in any way. So one thing I can do for this, because I want a color to it, a really nice color to the shadow. So what I can do is I'm gonna paint everything in this color there. right? This is going to be my shadow. And then I'm just going to multiply it and play with the opacity. So see, it's interesting because now I can, if I go hue here, I can change the color of the shadow, you know, and you see how in her case, having a warm shadow makes her look a little bit more alive and sexy, you know. So I think in that case, it's appropriate to do that. Definitely quite pink in the shadow, you know, because that her whole body is a little bit, you know, sort of like her dress is so saturated that it probably sort of radiates a little bit of light that is bouncing back from the dress onto the character. And that's why you see when you see people in sunlight, they wear a bright t-shirt like yellow or blue, and you'll see that it will color their skin a bit. So that's kind of what we're trying to do here. And that also helps to give, am I gonna be able to paint this or what? Hold on. Yeah, and this is gonna help to also suggest a bit of knee, which was always nice to have, you know, on a character. So I feel like now she's definitely getting more serious now, you know, about her whole attitude and you know, she's definitely moving. She's in motion now. That's really what I wanted to get. Hopefully, I'm a bit happier now. I'm not gonna say, you know, this is fantastic, but and I think we can use that dress to suggest a bit more motion, even, you know, like flapping this way. You know, so it's just generally a nicer shape, you know, like all nice curves. It's definitely an opportunity also to introduce what I was telling you about trying to get all those nice curves, you know, in a nice lines in a character like this. It's definitely something that is a good thing to have. Okay, so well, we're getting quite close now, I think. Definitely quite close. It's interesting now, I'm sure, to look at the let's compare to the small character. And how the essence is the same, but she changed quite a bit. Here it was interesting, suggested the inside of the dress actually, so I thought that could have been an interesting thing to do, an interesting thing, but I think we're fine with doing this there. Okay. The good thing too is that the sequins now they won't look so enormous like they were there. I'm gonna have the ability to make the sequin look a lot more interesting, and so hopefully where I am here. Sorry, still the cold is, it's kind of my throat is still a little bit weird, so apologize for the noise in the mic. I wonder if I want to suggest just a bit of cleavage, because her cleavage is you know, pretty much an essential feature of the character, I suppose. You know, I mean, it's not even a joke, you know, I mean, look at this is obvious, you know. Actually, there's a super funny joke in the movie, if you remember, the weasels, they all they're always a little pervy with her, you know. And but also they work for, what's the name of the guy, the evil dude, played by Christopher Lloyd. I can't remember his name now. The evil toon guy. He's so amazing, this character. And anyway, he has the weasels, you know, and they die of laughter at some point because they can't resist a good joke. But anyway, at some point, Jessica Rabbit and Eddie Valiant and everyone, Roger Rabbit, they get captured at the end, you know, and they want to dip them, you know, at least toons in the dip to kill them. And then they get captured, and then the evil guy, what's his name? Oh, you know what? I have to look it up. Hold on. I hate when I can't remember a name of a character. Give me a second. It is Judge Doom. How can I even forget this? Judge Doom. So Judge Doom has the, you know, his henchmen there, the weasels, and he asks the weasels to frisk them, the all the characters, to see if they have weapons or whatnot. And obviously one of the weasels takes the opportunity to be a little zealous about the way he searches Jessica, and he puts his hand into the cleavage, and it kind of goes in forever, you know, because it's like a hammer space, you know, it's infinite, like if you know the expression in the tunes, the hammer space, because you can put anything in there. And then there's a giant bear trap that encloses on the weasel's hand paw, and he takes it out. And then Eddie Valiant says something like "nice booby trap," you know, which is a fun use of the language. So anyway, our cleavage, I think, is definitely part of the story, you know. So we'll see if we can. I don't want to overdo this. I think it would be nice to feel it, but if I can't, I'd rather not have it than overdo it. Let me pick that color. Was a really fun movie. I'm really glad that they that's interesting. Hold on. Maybe I should do this actually. Trying to determine if I can take some freedom with the shape of everything here. There's a better way of doing this. It's always that one pixel, you know. It's that heart shape that's really nice, you know, and I wonder if I could get this a bit better, but I'm not quite sure. Maybe I need to go more. Oh yeah, maybe like this, more equal, you know. Maybe that's the way to go. And then we can suggest a little bit of cleavage, maybe. Very tricky. We don't want to. Don't know. I like the shape. At least we got that. So that's a bit better. Yeah, I think this is more interesting. It's too big, that line. It's not pretty, you know. Definitely not pretty. Not sure this is a good idea. By the way, yesterday I watched that famous what's his name? Walking Dead episode. Since I was in the I just recorded it, you know, and then yeah, that's it's confirmed that Walking Dead is not doing great. That episode, man, was a little hard to watch. I don't know what they tried to do there, but certainly didn't resonate with me very strongly. Was a bit was not that's not impressed. Let's put it that way. Not impressed. I think they had some interesting ideas, but again, everything felt just a bit it's not very, very well done overall. Like the whole going into the history museum to get that carriage there was just like, wow, really? I mean, is there really nothing else that they can use that they have to go into this museum? And then the whole glass floor is just it's just a bit silly, you know it's gonna crack, and it's just so it's just too obvious, all that stuff. And I was like, at some point I was like, if it ends up never cracking, I'll be happy, because then I'll be like, okay, at least you got me there, you know. You made it look like it's gonna crack the whole time, but it won't. And then I would have been, I would have been okay with that. But now, of course, had to crack. It's like, wow, really? Come on. I don't know. I think it's, it was, disappointing again, at least to me. It's not that I have huge, expectations about The Walking Dead now, but still, I used to care about that show, and now I feel like I'm kind of always a bit disappointed still, because I still have this hope that they're gonna sort it out, and do something interesting with it. But they don't seem to be able to really solve any of this now. So it's like it's almost like they forgot what was cool about it, or that's a better leg, I think. I'd be curious to know, actually, is this just, I mean, because to be fair, it's normal to have for any show to have a sort of any enterprise, a human enterprise. think it's just normal at some point to feel like you know, there's a sense of get tired of doing the same thing, and it starts to show, you know. But is it that, or is it something else? Is it because they changed people, or is it because they're really tired of doing it, or I wonder. I don't know, maybe I'm the exception. I mean, maybe most people are still you know, happy with it. So, I mean, it's possible. Maybe I'm just a bit too demanding, or not too sure, but how people feel, know. Okay. I think we've worked enough on that area. Well, I definitely want to. Sorry, actually, just as I'm saying this, I realized that I'm far from finished. I want to just a bit of lighting there as well, you know, like a bend in the dress. I think it would be nice to feel this. Can afford that. Doesn't have to be super complicated, you know, but. I think it would be an interesting little detail. Just give it a little bit of a, you know, and as usual, something like this, you can cut a little bit in it. So that's your it's not only lighting that informs the shape, but also the silhouette. Like this, not too bad. So now we got her doing this. That's, I think that's nice. Okay, we can go maybe a little less. Like that. Flip her. Always flip, because gives you a fresh look. Remember when I was drawing on paper and stuff, I used to look at my stuff in a mirror all the time. You know, I had a mirror, and I would just look at it, you know, and just look it in the mirror, and it would be like, oh crap, it's horrible. You know, but at least now in Photoshop, even when it's horrible, you can there's a lot you can do to save it. At the time, it was sometimes a little heartbreaking when things would not look the way they were supposed to say the least. At least for me, you know. Because I've never been a really good drawer. I don't draw very well. Actually, don't draw well at all. And I'm not. It may sound weird, or like I'm making stories or whatever. Because you'd think that if you do this sort of stuff, you like to draw, and I like to draw. I like to paint, but I don't really like to draw. I think there's a difference. I like painting light and suggesting. You know, I never do. I never do like. I never pencil in, and I never do line art when I paint. even characters going and blocking. It's just like here. If it was a big full-on illustration, I would do the same. But it, instead of pixels, I would lasso shapes, and then, or I would paint with a big opaque brush like this. You know, I would take this, and I would go like this. You know, I would start doing this sort of stuff. You know, and then erase to try and find the silhouette. You know, and all that sort of stuff. This is how I would do. And then eventually I would start, you know, selecting areas and then doing the shading, you know, that sort of stuff. That's how I would, so it's really a painting directly rather than there's no line art, then like color and, you know, it's different. And that's why I don't, because I never really draw things. That's why I'm a bad drawer. I don't really practice nearly as much as I should if I wanted to become decent. Trying just to see the hands, if there's anything a bit more interesting I could do. Oops, ooh, big brush. But maybe a little finger up there. Oh yeah, that's nice. It's almost feel like just get her hand on her hip, and then there's a little, you know, like her kink. This kink is her finger, you know. So yeah, I like that. This doesn't work the same. Something like this. Oh, what am I doing? Okay. I think we can try and shade just a bit the hair. We'll see if it's worth doing or not. Yeah, I think you could do that. And then have this spot a bit darker. Like this. Gonna try and even push a bit more lighting in that upper part. See if it's worth it. Yeah, I think we could do that, don't you think? It's one more information, you know, that we can use. To suggest shape in general. Gonna flip her just real quick. Yeah, I think it's nice. I think that's okay. We can do that. Maybe I'm just gonna push hair just a bit more there. Feels like it's not. Let's see. It's a bit too straight, so it's problematic, but it's nice if it feels like it's kind of resting on the shoulder. I hate that it ends up right there, the same level as the arm. But at the same time, maybe it's not necessarily a bad thing. Don't know if it's the best that I've done here for the hair. Let's see. Yeah, no, this was better. And that. No, I don't like this. Yeah, this is stronger. We're gonna keep this. Here we can maybe also suggest that this is more like a shadow. It's fine to do that. What else? No, we're definitely getting there now. Think we're definitely getting there. We could I guess we could just shade this a little bit. Shade the arms a little bit, but it's not as they're so thin that it's a bit tricky. Am I doing? So we could shade this a bit. Kind of feel maybe a little bit of a light hitting the top. Not sure though. I think I'm overdoing this a bit now. This is weird. Messing things up. Oh. Think this seems a bit extreme. Okay, yeah, I think this is getting almost complete now. So now obviously we need the sequins because this is an essential part of her, for sure, you know, like all the glitter. So let me see. So there's one way we can do this. We'll use another layer and we'll paint pure white for now. We're just gonna decide placement. So we probably want a bit more on the parts that are getting the most light, like this area. In this. too much in shadow, but we'll deal with that anyway. And now we're going to put this in the overlay. And you see what happens with the overlay is that every time you add one more layer, you're gonna get brighter and brighter. So good thing about that is that and screen would be the same. So we could go, you know, like this. But the problem is the screen is you're losing a lot of saturation. So we're gonna go overlay. Then we're gonna go one more. So that's my second layer. And this second layer, I'm going to erase parts of it so that not all the sequins are. And then another layer, which I'm going to erase a part of it too. And then another one, and this one. And so what this does is that it will leave only a few pixels that are really brighter, right? So with that, we can play with this sort of like, you know, because the sequence, what they do is that some of them catch the light at a perfect angle and they become really bright, and some of them a little less, so on and so forth, you know. So then by using my different layers, I can decide where I want the darkest. Oops. Spots where I want the brightest spots. There you go. And then I commit to it. And now I'm gonna take some of them. And then we'll play even more with that, but it takes some of them, change the hue and the saturation a bit, because I want to make sure that they don't all look the exactly same color, you know. Oh, so I need to make sure I just keep take just one pixel. Maybe this guy. Maybe that guy. Maybe this one. And then I'm gonna take a pure white now. Maybe choose so make a couple really bright, not a big fan of this one. So now I just, it was mainly to find different colors and intensities, and now I can just adjust this a bit, you know, make sure everything looks right. Maybe too much there. So we can play with that a bit. Different hue. Change the hue. We're gonna go more, a bit more orange. This. So So see, there's quite a bit we can do with that trick. It's just a matter of using common sense and a little bit of taste, you know, your own taste, and just trying to find what's what works the best. I can use this to accentuate some areas, you know, like that suppose there's a tie there, so this catches quite a bit of light, so we're going to use this to suggest that. You see here, same, there's the hip there, so it would make sense to try and go a bit brighter there. Like that. And a bit of on the breast. And I think we're more or less okay. Okay, that gives her that little glitter, you know. Obviously, we can't do too much because the pixels are so big, and it might look a little weird. Try one more somewhere. I don't want it to be too systematic. I hate to do one on each book because, you know, it might look like too systematic there and a bit weird. So let's do this. I think it's enough. And there we can maybe suggest a bit more lighting there. Whew. Okay, are we done? I think we're pretty much I think I'm about to be done now. I think the personality, her personality is there more or less. I'm okay with the pose. The hair. I guess now I could do, sometimes I'll do this, see, I think it's worth, she's a little, I think I could push the saturation a little bit for her, just for her, because she's that vibrant, super bright, you know, beautiful, you know, sequin dress, and I think we can afford to do that a bit, not too much, but you know, and sometimes I'll do this, you know, go like super extreme, get like full on saturation. And then now look, if I go back to normal, you see, it's a bit dull. I think we can do that. And I think also we could add a little bit of red overall on her. And, cause I want really her skin to take that nice red tint. I think we can probably get a bit of, I'll tell you what, first, before the saturation, we're gonna add the red first, because the red will saturate everything a bit. So we're gonna add some red, especially in the mid-tones, and a bit of blue and red in the highlight. So you see how, you know, she gets a lot more light. She feels more like she's almost emitting light now. So, a bit much, but that's kind of the idea. You see, kind of dull to a bit more vibrant. Our skin is more interesting. Play with the levels a bit. I think we can go a little brighter. On skin, high contrast for on skin. I think I want to, in that case, I'm going to have to isolate the skin. Unfortunately, it's a bit tedious, but I think it's worth doing. I don't want to mess up the dress by getting too much contrast in it now. So I'm just gonna select the skin real quick. Won't be long, there's not that much showing. Can use the magic wand there. Very convenient tool. Let's look at the mask. So we're good. So now I'm gonna just crank just a bit of light in her skin. Not too much. There's barely anything now. So that's extreme, you know. But I want her skin to look pale, you know, and to have a nice contrast between the skin and the dress and everything. So that's why I'm doing this like this, and then we're going to even put even more red in it and more yellow. Get the saturation up. And now we can look back to where we were before. Oops. From here to there. Not much difference, but look at the thigh. Look at this spot to here. See, just getting a bit more light. I think I'm happy with that. Now we're gonna move her around. And you see, she pops really nicely. She's definitely a superstar now. It's kind of the idea. She's very tall. I'm just gonna probably have to make her just a bit more, a bit smaller. I don't mind that she's extremely tall. I think it's just fun. But I think it might be just one pixel too much. We're just gonna remove, you know, 2 inches out of her, and she'll be 6 foot instead of 6'2". Boom. Done. Let me see if I if it would be worth doing this. No, I don't think I want to do that. But here there's a little bit of an issue with the. Gonna have to anti-alias this a bit. Okay. Just a bit less tall now. I think it's better. Feels more in line compared to. Interesting what happened there. Compared to see pretty big. And but you know she's standing really really proud and she's got those very high heels, so I think it's fine to do that. I don't think it's too crazy. And even on her heels, she's still about as tall as Indy, which you know is probably fine. She's taller than Sarah Connor, but I think Sarah Connor, to me, she's She's not that big. In her, she's more in action. She's definitely much more squat. So Sonia is a bit looks a bit smaller, but she's not that much smaller, and she doesn't have the heels either. I think I went a bit far in saturation. Just gonna go down just a bit, but not on the skin though. So unfortunately, I have to. Well, actually, you know. Yes, hold on. This needs to be addressed. It's too much saturation there. That's one thing. And then we're gonna just a bit of saturation. Somewhere there, I think it's fine. Yeah, I think it's better. So, yeah, Jessica's there. It's funny to see her next to Pinhead. It's like, hey, did you open the box? And she's like, nope, honey, don't know what you're talking about. Okay, I'm out. Thanks. Yeah, cool. Okay, nice. I think I like her. She turned out all right, I think. Definitely didn't come easy, that's for sure. We're past 3 hours now. Oh my, that's crazy. What can I say? This is me, you know. I'm not super fast. It's just the way it is. Hey, that's cool. Look at that. Our girlfriend for Forrest. Oh, he's got Jenny. He doesn't care. Next to Conan. Yeah, so I think she's about right. I think she's still maybe oversaturated. But I like her to be saturated. I'm a bit sad if I have to go down even more. So I want her to be in line with everyone, but at the same time, I kind of want her to be like that sultry, fun character. So I don't mind if she's a bit oversaturated. I think it's about right. Okay. Oh man, there's still this thing. There's a little bit of a. There. Okay, so we're gonna. I'm not too sure about that, but I don't know how to solve this now, and I'm getting very tired now. So I'm just gonna close the stream. Let's give her a shadow real quick. We're gonna name her Jessica Rabbit. And then let me add so where should she be next to where is he, this guy, who's our friend, he's up there, hold on, up there with no, I'm confused, I'm looking for Dave Bowman. Dave Bowman is here. Okay. Next to Tony Montana. So I guess I will do that. Gonna have to reorganize them at some point, but that's fine. And the shadows are all in one layer. Because for now I don't really have to deal with that. And gray shadow is not super great for her. I'm gonna do a little bit of an exception for her and give her a special shadow. Actually, you know what? All the characters, they shouldn't have gray shadows. Gray shadows are not fun. Let's see if we can give them a little bit of a color to their shadow, like a little blue, you know? Look at that. So much. So much nicer, I think. It's a bit too much, but yeah, just a bit of color for the shadow is just a nice touch. So we'll do that, I think. We don't need to go too bright here. Too dark. I'm gonna do that for the shadows. Feels nicer to me, like outside, you know. Yeah, I think that's all right. I'm gonna do this. I'll do the same for the cars, but offline. So there you go. There you have it. Hold on. Just got. Oh, damn. Yeah, we're done with her, I think, and so it's been a fairly long stream actually. Thank you everyone. I hope you you liked that character. It was good fun to make her. Definitely a bit of a challenge, more than I expected actually, but. That's what's fun about pixel art. You never know what to expect, and you have to adapt. So thanks again. Thanks everyone for being here. So now remember, we're gonna change the time at which we're gonna stream. It's gonna be 9 p.m. now every time, and then I'll see you the next time. It's gonna be Friday now, 2 days from now. 9 p.m. and we'll see what we do. I'm not too sure again. We'll probably decide. Maybe I'll decide at the last minute and tweet what I'm gonna do as usual. So yeah, there. Thank you again for being here. Follow me if you want to be told by Twitch whenever I come online. I hope I'll see you now on Friday. At 9. Thank you again. Bye.